Hope you guys.
So good evening and welcome once again. I've now started the recording because I forgot to do it before. So welcome to Yoga Cafe, Yoga Journeys, just inviting in a couple more people. So these connection cafes started up during lockdown. It was just a way for us to communicate while everything was, you know, shut down. And then obviously in the light of the Black Lives Matters movement, I was asked how I would like to, you know, have some space with more yoga to amplify the voices of melanated yoga teachers, or amplify melanated voices. So I came up with the idea of speaking to lots of yogis of colour and just finding out their journey, asking the same 10 questions, but the answers are all so wide and varied, which is just the beauty of, you know, individual journeys. So this evening we have joining us live from South London, David.
Thank you. Thank you guys for joining this evening. Thanks so much. I just hot-footed it here because I teach around the corner at Yoga Rise, 6 or 7. It was quite a busy class. I have a dog as well, so you'll see her in a minute. So I had to hot-foot here. I have responsibilities. She's got a little pup, and she's being fed at the moment. And then I wanted to be here on time and present. So thank you so much for joining. And I hope you had a great day so far.
Marvelous. Okay, so same 10 questions. We're just going to get stuck in. So first question, honouring our ancestors, tell us your family lineage.
So my parents are from a place in South America called Guyana. They're Guyanese. And my ancestors are from, the majority of them are from North India. And I think they went to the Caribbean for work. My dad's been doing the family tree, and then it's so interesting. And then we have got on my father's side some European ancestry as well from Spain.
Amazing.
It's quite an interesting, but my heritage is because a lot of people from Asia went to work in different parts of the world. I think it was in the 19th century. And then my family, my parents are both, they're Hindu, and they gave us the option of whether we wanted to practice or not. And I quite like the Hindu religion. So my dad was, his kind of mantra was the most important thing was to be nice to people. And so that's kind of, it goes, well, that was our kind of our religion as such.
To be nice to people.
Yeah, that was the only thing, always be nice to people. And that's, but my ancestry is it's from North India. My grandparents were, I think they were born in Guyana, and then we have some European as well.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. So where, when, and with whom was your first yoga class?
Oh, it was when I prepared for this, because those who come to my class, you know, I can talk and I like to play and everything else. So I wanted to stay to a point, but my journey started really, my journey with yoga started with my father. So my father has a self-practice, he practices Ashtanga, and so I've always practiced with him. So my first class was probably with him. I remember being in a diaper practicing next to him. And then in my kind of infancy and my teenage years, I used to practice with him. We used to do the whole sequence, the primary sequence. And then I used to run at school. I was in a running club. And college, and I had an injury, and I'd still practice yoga, but not that often, and I didn't stretch properly, and you know what happens, you finish the run, you stretch by the weekend, and you want to shower and eat, that's what was in my mind, and so I tore my hip flexor, the physio recommended yoga, and was a no-brainer, so I used to practice with my dad, but because of work, I went to, I think it was a Bikram class, so it was way back, and it was in 2009,
okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then what happened was my hip, I was going to physio, but my hip just healed, but literally within a week, the heat seemed to work with it. I'm not a massive fan of heat all the time, but it did work. Mm-hmm. And I was just hooked, literally hooked, because it fitted in with my lifestyle of working in the city. I used to go to class, and I did that for a couple of years, and then that was my first class in terms of in a studio, I guess.
Okay, so what was the work in the city? You mentioned city work. What was the city work?
Oh, I worked for a charity, and I looked after the commercial part of the charity. And it was quite taxing on my brain. Everyone, come on, Loki. This is my puppy, Loki. Oh, bless you, bless you.
Bless you.
Now she's going to be playful. Come sit here. So yeah, I worked in the commercial part, so in the enterprise part of the charity, and it was raising money. It was raising money, and it was space planning, and while it lasted, it was a very interesting job. But like with all jobs, I knew kind of coming up to year five, I didn't really want to. It wasn't my.
Okay, so when did you realize you wanted to teach yoga?
Well, we had Yvonne and I had a little chat. I thought, I'm going to be honest with you. So I didn't actually have any plans to teach yoga. If I'm really honest with you, at the time, it was 2015 when I did my yoga training. After I did Bikram for a couple of years, I practiced for 3 years, almost straight, with a Dharma yoga teacher, Mark Han, amazing Dharma yoga teacher in London. And I got to 2015 and I realized I didn't want to stay in what I was doing, and I wanted to do something different. I didn't know what that meant. But yoga teaching wasn't
in the life plan.
No, it wasn't in my, and if I'm really honest with you, I like shiny things. I still like shiny things, but a little less. And you know, I had to, working in the city, you know, one of the latest gadgets and everything else, and that was the thing for me. So I did my first teacher training with Shivananda, and I know you're gonna ask me that question, but the Swami was the one who said to me, the Swami who was running the training, he said to me before I even knew that he saw me teaching, and I said, no, Swamiji, it's not gonna happen. And then little did I know, I got back on the plane to go back home via Dubai from Kerala, and I just had this urge of quitting. So I quit. I didn't quit immediately because I'm very responsible. Months notice, I did work it, and everyone thought, you know, I would change my mind, but no, I didn't.
What do you think it was that made you change your mind? Because you said you had no intention, but then on the plane back something shifted. So what do you think it was?
It wasn't to teach, it was just to do something different. So I had savings, and I figured I was going to take some time out, travel. I liked yoga, I liked well-being, and then I was working my notice. I then did a yoga retreat, and what happened was my teacher then suggested that I do the Dharma 500 hour, and I'm like, I'm not ready. I don't even teach for the 200 hour. Why would I do 500 hours?
Okay, yeah.
Because I was going to go traveling, he suggested that I do that. I had enough classroom experience. You have to have 50 hours of Dharma. Well, I'd been practicing Dharma for 3 years nonstop, 6 days a week. Mm-hmm. So I had, and then I went to my 500 hour training, and when I came out of that, I was going to go traveling, but then I had the opportunity, it goes into, to run a studio, but we'll talk about that in a second.
Okay. So your first training was in Kerala?
Yeah, with Shivananda.
Shivananda, what year was that?
2015. Yeah, in February 2015, I remember it really well.
Amazing. So out of interest, how many people were of colour on the training with Shivananda?
They have a lot of individuals on the training, so they were quite...
Sorry, you broke up there, David. I don't know if it was just me.
They have... Can you hit now?
Yeah.
They have a lot of Indian nationals on the Shivananda trainings, because they really try to encourage a lot of the nationals to do the training. So it was quite a large training. There was something like 70 people on that training.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. At least a good third were from India, and some there were quite a few from I would say Asia. So there was a Chinese community with a translator, because it was There was my roommate, because you get to share with someone, was from Nepal, and there was a couple of people from Nepal. And then there was quite a large, I would say then there was probably at least two thirds actually from Asia, and then a third from Europe.
Okay.
Europe, I would say a third kind of like either from Europe or from, there were probably a dozen from London.
Okay. So, from the 70. Okay. So moving on to the highs and lows of the wellness industry, what comes to mind? So start with the low. We like to start with the low and then end with the high. So the lows that come to mind with the wellness industry.
I had to really think about this. And I guess for me, let's take more yoga out of this, because I think they're doing a great job. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
That are teaching for them, the people that are working for them, they kind of like, they put their money where their mouth is. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's you and I, and there's so many other people that we know that have an opportunity. I think it's a great platform for new teachers. Mm-hmm. And for all backgrounds. But I think some of the established studios, the multiples that have been around for a long time, I don't think they have a fair representation of, there's a lot of talent out there, and I don't see it always. Mm-hmm. They have talented people, there's no doubt about it, but there's so many other people out there, and a lot of them happen to be of colour, that I don't see represented in some of the bigger studios, the multiples that have been around for a long time.
Okay. Well, okay. So that's your low. What is your high?
Are we talking about lows of the wellness industry?
Yes, yeah. Doing on the wellness industry, highs of the wellness industries now.
So I think I have answered the wrong question. So, okay, but that we'll go back to that in terms of what needs to be changed outside. The lows for me, I will be honest, actually the lows, I ran a studio in 2015, and there's always a learn, everything we do, there's always learns from it. And there's no, I had to really think hard. So let's step back. And I think the lows for me, the low was running a studio, because I realized, because I'd worked in the city, I was like looking after people and running a business in the city. And running a studio is like running a business. There's no two ways about it.
And it is running a business.
I didn't want to, I realized quite quickly that wasn't my thing, to run a studio for someone else, because you get to see all sides of the business. And some of the things I saw I didn't like, it surprised me, because you just normally you see quite a front facing, and I didn't like all of what I saw, not everything. It was that was a challenge for me to manage that. I kind of, if I'm honest, I kind of fell out a little bit of love with yoga, right? Mm-hmm.
Because of running the studio.
Yeah, because it's very demanding. It was a studio in the city. It's an amazing studio, but it just, you know, some things are, that wasn't my dharma. But sometimes to find your dharma in life, you have to do a few things, and nothing is ever wasted, because there's a learn from it. I met some lovely people there. Mm-hmm. On your journey in whatever you go to do, you learn. So I have no regrets, but that wasn't one of the, it was one of the things that got me to where I am, so I'm grateful. So I don't necessarily, I'm kind of a glass half full kind of person.
Excellent. Okay, so that's the lows. What are the highs then?
The highs, well,
highs of the wellness industry.
Well, just the people that you get to meet, the students, getting to do something. Although I didn't want to be a teacher, I kind of like it kind of fell into place. I'd been traveling for a while, I got teaching, and then I thought, actually I quite like this, and I haven't seen it as a job. I don't see it as a job. I see it as service. And
yes,
yes. Meet some amazing people, and you get to work in some amazing places. You get to before I had a puppy, I loved traveling all over the place. I like to go into the city, I like to teach all hours of the day and night, and so that's the highs for me, just meeting really nice people, getting to do doing something that you really love. And I think my dad always says, if you do something that you really love, then it's not really a job. And I
That's interesting, because I think it was about 2006, something that stuck with me about the whole yoga journey, which I didn't realize I would be a teacher. It was like, there's an American inspirational speaker called, oh God, his name's just gone out of my head. It'll come back to me. But his strapline is, get paid for doing what you love. So Les Brown, that's his name, Les Brown. Get paid for doing what you love. So it's very similar to what you've just said. Okay, thank you. So moving on, what got you through lockdown?
Oh, having, if I'm honest, at first, like most people, I was like, oh my God. I didn't really register. I was one of the last I think we went into lockdown officially in the UK on the 23rd of March. So
23rd of March, 2020, yes.
So Misha and I went to film for More Yoga. Misha Patel, who you interviewed, I
think, two weeks ago.
She picked me up. And we went to do some filming for More, and then we it was surreal. Then I had to go and teach my last class in at the Light Centre, and normally that class is really full, and it hadn't registered. And then there was only a handful of people, and I was like, oh wow. And then I saw on the way there, I was trying to get an Uber, but there was no Ubers around, and it felt like a movie, being in a movie. But the day was quite overcast, and then it was the first time I saw people with like bandanas and their face coverings, like covering up, and people had their big desktops. They were taking a big desktop, and the hubs of their computers, like laptops. And I thought, wow, this for me was really serious. And then you're in your bubble when you're at home, and I kind of like what got me through was, I have a puppy to look after. She had just under, I think she was coming up to a year, and she, you know, when you have a puppy, it's like having a kid, you know, she bounds in here. So that kept me grounded, and gets you up every day. And then I have an amazing family. So kind of Asian families, they check on you all the time, too much. I haven't got enough money. And so I'm very fortunate. I have amazing friends, and the students were phenomenal. The amount of messages, they were asking me to go online, and they would support, and it was very, very heartwarming. And just speaking to some of the other teachers, what I found, there was such a camaraderie. Everyone wanted to help everyone. That was such a lovely thing to kind of get you through lockdown, and you supporting everyone. They were just wanting to help everyone. So everyone had circumstances, and that was really lovely.
Cool. So rest in peace, George Floyd. It seems to have been a shift in, you know, anti-racism, you know, studios trying to do better, people trying to, you know, educate themselves more, diversifying their feeds. Did you find you got many additional followers on social media during like the Black Lives Matters after George Floyd's killing?
No, I don't know. Not really. Not Instagram followers. No, I didn't get much. I got, the followers I've got, I use social media as a tool. I try not to, because you can, you know, first thing I would do in the morning before I had my pup, I would go into Instagram, and it would be the last thing I do at night. Mm-hmm. I find the more you post, the more followers you get.
And that's right, okay.
But I didn't necessarily get more followers, but I did get more people kind of wanting to go to, from my existing followers, going to class, like wanting to go into class, or kind of interested in I got a lot of people from New York, and I don't know if that's because when I post my stories, because I'm mainly, I teach Dharma, I always tag the Dharma.
Dharma NYC. Yeah.
So I'm in it, and then I was getting people from New York, and I find they repost and they have a wider following. I didn't. I mean, and back to the whole thing. I mean, pre-Corona, I hadn't listened to the news since 2015. When I left the city, I just didn't listen to the news.
Really? Okay.
I think I was told by one of the teachers or one of the teacher trainings that actually you'll find the news will come to you when you need it. And actually it served me really well up until that time. But then I found up until March, I found I needed to listen to the news just aware. So not to be, it's not that I wanted to be blissfully ignorant, but to be aware, because we're in the wellness industry, we need to know what's going on. Mm. We need to serve people better. So I started to listen to the news, and I don't really like listening to the news, and I would try to only listen to the news once a day.
Okay. And that's how I kind of
when the George Floyd thing happened, I was very sad. Literally sad, a little angry that this is still happening in present day in this present day. Very sad about it. In terms of the approaching of
studios,
a few people had approached me before lockdown. Some other people had approached me afterwards. Mm-hmm. And, I'm always grateful. I'm literally always grateful. But what happened was, because I live in South London, and I have a puppy. It's like having a kid. Literally, it's like having a kid. I would imagine. I haven't got kids myself, but my brothers have kids. Feels like it. So I have a responsibility. I don't want to leave the dog too long. To stay in South London. So they've approached me, and I've taken some work. So some starting this week, I'll be teaching for some studios. I don't know if that's because of the Black Lives Matters. I think it's a combination of things. I was speaking to a friend of mine. When you start out on your teaching journey, you're always trying to get your CV out there, but it's not like a normal CV. They want to see something on a video of your practice. Funny, and then when you relax, what happens after a while? You relax. More often than not, some of the students have recommended you to other studios that they practice in. Which is really sweet. That's why I love it. And then, the rest happens, and kind of magic happens when we relax. I relaxed a bit. I didn't worry too much. Not everyone's in that fortune. You know, some people have to, when you're starting off, I mean, it wasn't like that at the beginning. You are out there and you're trying not to, for me, I try not to use my contacts in the previous studio I worked in. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to get it on my own.
Right, yeah, on your own merit.
Yeah, the first year was a bit tough, to say the least.
Okay.
The other studios have contacts here, and I've taken some work.
Okay, wonderful. So here's the opportunity where you get to promote whatever you've got coming up. So what does the rest of 2020 look like for you? Workshops, retreats, whatever you want to share, whatever you want to plug, and then we'll have time for Q&A.
Cool, thanks everyone. So going into lockdown, I had thought about it, about opening a yoga school, and
predominantly
so more than the practice. So the way I like to think that I teach, and I have been taught that the classes, it's a learning experience, and none of us are, you know, where, as my dad always says, we never stop learning until we we're always learning. And so I'd like to to open a studio, and it's a class, but the class is quite a learning experience, because if I'm honest, when we have an hour and 15 minutes, you need slightly longer, especially if you've got an all-level class. Mm-hmm. I try to encompass so that everyone has an opportunity to practice, and we're all at different stages of our yoga journey as such. Some people will be starting tomorrow. Some people have been practicing for many years. And so I think rather than a studio, call it a school, I registered the name and everything else, and I was looking for a space. And then I knew the time wasn't right. I knew the time wasn't right, but I knew that I need to you know, if you start doing things, I always believe that actually then the universe starts to put things into place, and then you kind of, you find the path and you just go down the path. That is, it's still not out of, it's not like number one, but it's still in the top five. And so for the rest of the year, I had some workshop plans that I postponed that I'd like to reintroduce. I used to do a workshop one or two a month. So, you know, I thought about this question when I was preparing for our interview, and we're already in September. So before you know it,
Happy New Year.
Yeah. Not much, there isn't much left. Try not to wish it away. So and I'm planning to go back to, as we come out of our kind of Zoom, I'm still going to do some Zoom because I'm teaching long.
I think a lot of people will keep some Zoom going.
I'm planning to
keep, I think it's a nice balance.
Yeah, so, and it works so well for a lot of people, where especially if they have to set off early in the morning, or they come home late and then they can't get to the studio. They know there's one day where they can hit a Zoom class where, or they can just take the laptop and do it in the office, then it nicely. So I'm planning to do a couple of workshops, go back to the studios. And I didn't really plan too much for the end of the year, because pre-lockdown, I planned to take December off. Go to India, go back to Shivananda. There's another training. I mean, I've done quite a lot of training. My parents are real, they're real fans of my learning, but my dad say, like, how much training do you want to do? So I want to do this Sanskrit and puja training.
Oh, amazing. Amazing.
And it's just because I teach most days because it fits in with my lifestyle, but also so we continue to be of service, that there's always more things that we can learn. So I was planning to do that. And I was planning to, on the way back, maybe go to Thailand and do a bit more Thai massage, because I'm a body worker as well. And when we're allowed to assist and adjust, I used to introduce a little bit of Thai massage into the class.
Amazing. So talented.
Well, still a lot to learn. So
yeah. That's really excellent. Incredible. Do you have a preferred studio where you run the workshops, or just does it depend what's going on?
So I will tend to do, I mean, for the last couple of workshops, there's a beautiful space at Yoga Point in Brixton. Run the workshops there. But because of social distancing, I've really got to be, because our care, not only are we looking after ourselves, but we have our families, our extended family.
Absolutely, yeah, and so on and so on and so on, yeah.
For the sake of running the workshops, until there's some vaccine outside, we have to be really careful. So I've got to see how it will work. And those workshops were, I would never pack it full, because no one learns from that. I don't get anything out of it. And for me, part of the fulfillment I get is seeing people progress. So there was always normally about 20 people, but I don't know if it fit into a space now where you have to have such a distance around the mat where you can't assist people as well. I'm finding it a struggle. If I'm totally honest, for those who come to class, I'll be put my hand up. You know how hands-on, pre-locked, I like to adjust. Not unnecessarily, I like to think, but I like to assist and adjust. And then
being of service.
Yeah, not being able to do that hand. But it's been a learn as well, because also these things happen in life, and we have to. There's a lovely Swami in India, and he used to say, I think it was adapt, accommodate, accept. And this is one of the things that you have to do.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's good advice. Adapt, accommodate, and accept. Yeah, okay.
So in life, this is what's happened. In lockdown, for the first 3 weeks, I didn't really teach. And then I figured out, okay, so what, you know, my pup was, well, at the time, she was fairly well trained. And then, but also dogs are quite independent, so they need some time by themselves. So I then went back into, when I first went out to teach, you could do all the teaching, it's like driving a car, but you're by yourself. So I would practice in front of the mirror. So on Zoom, I'd practice, how does the camera look? How does this really kind of, I wanted to teach really as well as I could. So I wanted to, and then I tested it out, sent videos to my friends. What do you think? They give me, you know, honest feedbacks that I can use. And then I got the equipment and then I went for it. And I at first it was very alien because you're looking at the camera and sometimes in some classes I have over 50 people. And I'm like, okay. And I found out
you've got to be scanning through all the different screens. Yeah.
I can't. So when it was a busy class like that, I would give them guidance right at the beginning because it serves no one when you keep going back and forward. Classes, we got to about 6 to 12 people. It was easy to teach.
Yeah. Okay. So before we open up to Q&A, is there anything you would like to add? Anything you forgot to mention? Any final thoughts before you get lots of questions, hopefully?
I don't know. I'd like to go back to that question where, you know, the highs and low, where I thought you, that was personal to me. So going back to the other studios, I go back to more yoga. When you look at the schedule and you look at the opportunities given to all the teachers, it's all encompassing. And you can see it from the students that come to class. And if one person like one teacher more than the other, then one person would be really busy and there'd be a whole lot of us not working. So I think, you know, I work for about 5, 6, 7 studios now, and all the studios I work for, they give a lot of people opportunities. They tend to be smaller, they have small multiples or independent studios, but bigger ones that go back to the question which I misinterpreted. I think it's the bigger studios where I'd like to see with the Black Lives movement, I'd like to see more sustained, because I think at the moment, so if you look and you turn on the TV, it's lovely to see it, but every commercial has someone of ethnicity, and it's lovely to see that. I'd like to see that come Christmas or come next year. And the same thing with the studios, because there's a lot of talent out there. There's a lot of talent out there. So
I would agree with you. I think sustained is a key word. And I think, yes, you know, I've been approached by studios. I've started with new studios. I've started with the platforms. And that's great. And it's just, let's hope that this time next year, it's still in play and it still continues. It's not just that one moment in time. Yeah. So, yeah, let's see. Okay. Any final words before Q&A commences?
I think we should let you. I could talk for ages, so let's start. You know, but thank you. Thanks for giving me your
okay. Wonderful. Okay, so thank you guys so much for being here, one and all, everybody that's tuned in this evening. So you're more than welcome to ask David a question. So you can put it in the chat box if you would like, or you can take yourself off mute and ask him directly. So over to you. Don't be shy. You can see David loves to chat, so please give him a couple of questions. Don't let him off easy. He loves to chat. Ask him a question, please.
I'll call my puppy.
And it's lovely to see Bill. Hello, Bill, one of my regulars in restorative.
Oh, hello, Bill.
So nice to see, because on YouTube you don't see, but now I can see on Zoom. Thank you for tuning in. Come on, one of you must have a question. They must want to know something. We won't pull teeth, but you know, I just thought there would be one question.
I've been let off easy.
Yeah, too easy. Oh, hold on, there's one. You spoke too soon. Okay. So, hi, thanks for this interview. I don't have a question, but I would like to say that it was great to hear more about David. Missing your yoga classes in Brixton. Hope to see you soon.
Oh, that's so cute. Thank you.
That's from Raquel.
Oh, thanks, Raquel. So, I'm back tomorrow, actually, in the morning, 7:30 to 8:30. To be honest.
In Brixton?
Yeah, in Brixton.
Amazing.
So I'm back. I've gone back. So I love, you know, and Brixton's one of the studios where I used to teach quite a lot. But the classes pre-lockdown were ramped. So I haven't promoted it so much. I think there's 12 spaces. We've just been sensible. You know me, when people used to turn up at the door, I'd always let people in. We've got to be careful. As I said, we've got to, for me, if I'm honest, the COVID, just going into lockdown, it didn't really register. But then we see all these people, it's very sad that young men, all ages have been affected by it. Then it makes us realize that we have to be responsible. That's part
absolutely.
Of the...
Absolutely.
And it'll be every Tuesday, and then I'm going to go back to, I said that we're trying to do something on a Sunday. So I do teach yin, and I do teach a restore class. It used to be on a Sunday. And then we're going to go back to Balham at some stage. So probably three students, but we're easing out. And there's a lot of teachers still not, you know, that are not working. So everyone needs to be given the opportunity. But thank you so much. Thanks, Raquel, for that.
Raquel says she'll see you in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, definitely.
Back in a couple of weeks. Okay, if there are no questions, you will be let off easy. You will go. Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in. On the 21st of September, I have a yoga teacher called Lildona Lawrence. She will be joining us. She's not a more yoga teacher. She's a yoga teacher of colour from other studios. And she's an actress, and she's got a really wonderful varied background. So do tune in on the 23rd. Thank you so much for joining, and thank you so much for David for sharing your journey.
Thank you so much, guys.
Good night all.
See you. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome. Thanks for all the nice comments. Yes.
Thanks, Sue.
Take care.
See you guys.
You're very welcome.
See you,
thanks,
Kelly,
for all your nice comments. Thank you both. Really enjoyed having people hearing their stories and their journey. So that's nice. Thank you, Sue. Thanks for tuning in again.
Thanks. Bye bye.
Take care.
Oh, Gloria. Thanks so much. See you, Gloria. Oh, that's so cute.
Isn't it?
You'll do good. We're going to recommend you for the news.
Okay, I'm going to end and I'll ring you.
Okay, cool. See you guys. See you, Kelly. Look after yourself. See you soon.